In 1998, while strolling through the Kansas City Mall, Larry Martin, a paleontologist at the University of Kansas, found displayed in a store window a cast of a strange fossil that captured his interest. Today, I have here a copy of the same fossil, originally found in the Middle Triassic Matijin Formation in the Fergana Valley in Kyrgyzstan. Welcome to another video on the fossil record. My name is Benjamin Berger, and in this video, I want to reconstruct this little fossil and discuss the major controversy that erupted over it 20 years ago, a controversy that divided the scientific community into two warring camps. Larry Martin learned that the tiny fossil had been collected in 1966 and had been described in a paper by the Russian paleontologist Alexander Chavrot. Now, Chavrot had been collecting fossils from the Matijin Formation for many years for the Paleontological Institute in Moscow. He was actually looking for fossil insects preserved in the ancient lake deposits within the valley. Now, the Triassic period is a really important age for the study of insects and their recovery from the end Permian mass extinction. And while looking for insects, Chavrot collected several really strange specimens of ancient reptiles, including a beautifully preserved pterosaur, which he named Sortes pilosus. Now, pilosus means hairy, and this fossil was one of the first examples of pycnofibers, of hair-like filaments on the pterosaur. Now, Sortes is one of the most primitive pterosaurs ever discovered. Another fossil that he found was Chiroveropteryx, a early long-limbed gliding reptile that was renamed in his honor. Now, the tiny fossil that we're going to be talking about is this one. And he named it Longisquama, which means long scales. And what makes Longisquama so bizarre is that it appears to have these long scales or filaments that extend out of the animal more than 4 or 5 times longer than the little body. Now, several other specimens were found as well, and they're all housed at the museum in Moscow. Now, news of the discovery of this little fossil did not reach the United States, but French researchers suggested that the long scales that extend off could have been paired and used in gliding. So shortly after describing the specimen, Chavrot actually sadly passed away in 1973, and the specimens remained in the museum. But casts were made, like this one, and sent out in the 1990s. And it was one of these casts of the original specimen that Martin saw in the shop window in the Kansas City Mall that day. Larry Martin was a kind and generous man, but loved stirring up the pot. He often played the contrarian in scientific debates. I found a wonderful quote attributed to him by Mike Evhart, where he is said to have said, "There is no shortage of fossils. There's only a shortage of paleontologists to study them," which I think is a great quote. Now, Martin's response in learning about this cast was to contact the museum in Moscow and ask to borrow the actual specimens to study. And in 1999, Martin invited groups of American paleontologists to take a look at the original specimen. And where Chavrot had seen long scales, Larry Martin suggested that the long filaments on the back of the specimen were actually feathers. In 2000, the group of scientists believing that the filaments were feathers published a very controversial paper in the journal Science, reinterpreting the fossil as having long pinnate feathers, the oldest feathers ever discovered, and predating both dinosaurs and birds. Now, the paper instantly drew a lot of controversy, even from American paleontologists who had viewed the original specimen that Martin had brought in. So they argued that these long filaments were just, in fact, just scales rather than feathers. Now, because this specimen is an impression, it's difficult to reconstruct the fossil. Furthermore, the fossil lacks a really well-preserved skull. It's lacking the hind limbs and the hip. So that makes it really difficult to classify. So some argued that the fossil was the earliest dinosaur, while some relative to pterosaurs, while others placed it within archosaurs, and even others placed it as an early relative to modern lizards. Now, rebuttals to the proposal that the filaments represented feathers were swift, with replies from various scientists refuting the idea. Paleontologists were either aligned with the pro-feather group, some of which even argued that birds shared ancestry with this fossil, and the pro-scale group, who argued that Longisquama was just an early lizard with these elongated scales. Martin wanted to prove that these were really feathers, and the only way to do that was to find new specimens. One of the pro-feather researchers was Igiva Kurushkin at the Paleontological Institute of the Russian Academy of Sciences in Moscow, who was an author of the controversial paper. So funds were raised for an additional collection from the original fossil site, which had become part of the independent country of Kyrgyzstan, having broken away from the Soviet Union in 1991. Igivi Kurushkin returned to the original site, but by early 2005, the country of Kyrgyzstan was enveloped in the Tulip Revolution, and rioters ransacked the capital. But during this collecting effort by Russian and also some German scientists, a new reptile fossil was found, which was subsequently named Kyrgyzstosaurus. The fossil exhibited these fantastic impressions of scales along the head, neck, but missing was the posterior part of the animal and whether it had long filaments along the back. The animal was classified as a member of the Drepanosaurid family, a group of bizarre primitive archosaurs known from the middle to late Triassic, and researchers suspected that Longisquama might be also a member of this family of early Triassic lizard-like creatures. Now, Drepanosaurids are believed to be the sister group to both pterosaurs and early dinosaurs, and are found only in the Triassic period, going extinct at the Triassic-Jurassic boundary around 200 million years ago. A lot of the debate on the classification rests on whether Longisquama exhibited an anorbital fenestra, whether it had a crocodile normal or reverse ankle joint, and the nature of the hip socket or acetabular foramen. If preserved, these traits would allow paleontologists to actually classify the fossils better. But for now, most suggest the Longisquama is probably most likely a member of the Drepanosauridae family, but others are kind of more cautious until we have some additional fossils preserving different parts of the animal. Now, in 2012, German paleontologists Michael Butschwitz and Sebastian Vogt published a very detailed reinterpretation of the filaments, suggesting that they were something completely unique, perhaps a developmental precursor to filaments seen in pterosaurs and dinofuzz, and not specifically feathers. In fact, rather than picking a side between the two debating groups, they suggested that the filaments were an early integumentary structure that, while not true feathers, were ancestral to later feather-like structures. Now, The study points to the fact that early archosaurs in the early to middle Triassic exhibited some novel integumentary structures that would eventually evolve into the pterosaur pycnofibers, things like dinosaur quills and dino fluff, and eventually true feathers. Now, one trait that these filaments on Longisquama have is their central shaft that is supporting them. Evidence also shows that these little filaments were not paired, but a single dorsal row along the back, and were not used in gliding or flying, but most likely for display purposes, by making the animal look much bigger than it was. And these filaments could be raised and lowered by flexing the longissimus back muscles under the skin, and were stiff and wide at the ends for maximum effect, to make it look really much bigger than it was. So today what I'm going to try to do is I'm going to try to reconstruct this animal, make a reconstruction, and I'm doing so, I'm going to be relying on this little cast here, as well as images of other specimens and scientific papers, as well as looking at modern animals. Now, one thing I've noticed in just looking at them is that the filaments are longest on the anterior side along the back near the head, and they become kind of progressively shorter towards the back of the animal. These filaments were thick, likely covered in like skin-like folds, but supported by a cartilaginous or maybe keratin sheath internally. So they don't plume out like you see with feathers. And there is one specimen preserved with these guys kind of laying on top of each other, folded back. So these kind of remind me a little bit of the thick dorsal scales found in modern iguanid lizards, but particularly the green-crested basilisk, which has a crest on the head, but also these long, along spine supported by scales along the back and even the tail. Now, all of these spines along the back are not supported by bone, but soft tissue. And I think that was definitely the case with Longisquama, otherwise we'd see some bone inside here. Now, the gliding Draco lizards, which live today, actually form a membrane from bone supported by an outgrowth of the ribs. But we don't see any bone support for these filaments in Longisquama. So modern Draco lizards, which are often invoked in reconstructions that I've seen, are likely probably not the best to compare, since they're gliders with a membranous wing on either side of the body rather than along the back. And there's no evidence in these guys that there was a membrane between these filaments coming out like you see in pterosaurs and other gliding animals. So it just appears like these long sort of spikes coming out. So in the reconstruction, I've added a little insect, a damselfly, which evolved during the early Triassic. Now, damselflies are found in Asia from the same time period and likely was a food source for this tiny animal. It also serves kind of as a scale of how small Longisquama was in life. So my final reconstruction, it's a little larger than life size. It's a weird and strange animal that many others have attempted to reconstruct it as well. So I've tried hard to make this image as scientifically as accurate as possible, but a lot of the body, I've had to reference modern animals such as small lizards. I'm going to draw two names to send this and my previous artwork, a skull of Nanotyrannus, to two supporters of my Patreon page. So if you'd like a chance to own some original artwork, there's a link in the description below in my Patreon page, where you'll not only get a chance to own some of this original paleo art, but also some behind the scenes features that I post from time to time that aren't publicly viewable on YouTube. Like my recent video on the casting of a fossil for a museum I did a few weeks back. All right, so the first name I'm gonna draw here is for the Nanotyrannus skull. And it's gonna go to Mark Widdick. So Mark Widdick, I'll send this out to you and the longissimus. This one is gonna go to Emmett Larson. Ah! So I will send those out in the mail. I'll probably message you on the Patreon page if I don't have your address, and I will get those mailed out to you guys. Congrats. So many of you may have noticed that my YouTube channel has disabled comments. This is something I knew was going to happen on YouTube this year. My videos are available to viewers under the age of 13. And since I talk about prehistoric animals and dinosaurs and they're popular with kids, my channel falls into that group of channels which will have comments disabled. So YouTube comments have been kind of a mixed bag for me. I can't keep up with the flood of mostly positive comments. And I spend way too much time moderating them. So you'll likely see, YouTube's also disabled for many other videos on YouTube this year, so I'm not the only one being affected by this. I'm planning on taking my online discussions of my videos onto Reddit, where many YouTube channels are moving their online discussions. However, if you support me on Patreon, you can comment on my videos there. And I do see and respond to those comments. So that's another perk for joining me over there. And with that said, I want to thank some of my truly amazing Patreons who go beyond the normal, including Brian Clever, my newest big Patreon, Crisp Green, Pablo Luzzatto Figuez, who's been one of my longest supporters, Magnus Solfang, Sean Cormett, Emmett Larson, congrats Emmett, Marlo and Draco, Fred Olney, and Niso. Thank you guys.